Hello, my name is Osama. Naga will start the pediatric board review of the cardiovascular system. You can follow with me in the pediatric board study guide from page 313 to page 317. In this section, we'll discuss the chest pain, syncope, murmur, and congestive heart failure. I would like to start with this clinical case scenario. This is a 15 years old adolescent boy who brought to you for evaluation of chest pain. He had a chest pain 2 days ago during a soccer game and had to leave the game. He describes the pain as dull and points to the middle of the chest. It was worse when he was running. The pain is 9 out of 10. The pain resolved with rest and the fluids. He denied rapid heartbeat sensation. He had similar episode few months ago. It usually happens when he is pushing himself and running. His family history is significant for asthma and hypertension. No family history of sudden death or death under age of 30 years. He denied using illicit drugs or drug abuse. Physical examination is normal, but when he was in the clinic, he's experiencing chest pain and feels anxious. The EKG showed ST segment elevation in the anterior and lateral leads, V1 to V6, with ST segment depression in the inferior leads. What is the most likely diagnosis? The important point to look at this case presentation is that this adolescent is having chest pain, which is very common in adolescent, but the red flag here that this adolescent is having pain during exertion, not before, not after, is during exertion and is worse while he is running. And also the EKG is showing ST segment elevation, which is abnormal. This is a very important cause of sudden death in adolescents or athletes, which is anomalous coronary artery. Chest pain in children. The most common cause of chest pain in children and adolescents is non-cardiac, is not the heart. This is the most common. The history and physical examination can establish the diagnosis of pain in the majority of the cases. Cardiac chest pain is extremely rare in children and adolescents. Chest pain in children is rarely due to cardiac disease. Idiopathic chest pain. This is the most common cause of chest pain in children and adolescents. No identifiable cardiac, pulmonary, or musculoskeletal cause of the chest pain. This account 20 to 45% of cases of pediatric chest pain. No diagnosis can be determined with certainty and usually require reassurance. Cardiac disorders associated with chest pain, coronary artery disease. This is rare in children but can be seen in, for example, in kids or children with familial hypercholesterolemia, especially the homozygous type. This will cause premature coronary artery disease and will present with ischemia or infarction. History of Kawasaki disease, very important to ask any child with history of chest pain to ask about a history of Kawasaki, because this can cause coronary arthritis or aneurysm. Anomalous origin of coronary arteries. This is a very important cause of sudden death in athletes. Also, this can be presents even early during infancy with poor feeding, fussiness, and during childhood also can present with chest pain during exertion. Cocaine abuse can cause chest pain. Very important to ask about drug abuse in adolescent. Pericarditis, myocarditis, supraventricular tachycardia also can cause chest pain, so ask about history of palpitation. Other cardiac abnormalities can be associated with chest pain is aortic stenosis, aortic dissection, like in cases of Marfan syndrome. Marfan syndrome, aortic dissection, very important association. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, pulmonary hypertension, severe pulmonary stenosis, mitral valve prolapse. Red flag for cardiac chest pain, pain with exertion, syncope during exercise, syncope during running or swimming. This is abnormal. Fatigue and in babies will be poor feeding and fussiness, shortness of breath with exertion, pain preceded by tachycardia, like in cases of SVT or supraventricular tachycardia, familial history of heritable conditions such as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is a red flag. Musculoskeletal pain is a very important cause of chest pain in children and adolescents. They have a chest wall tenderness with palpation. They respond very well to non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medication, for example, ibuprofen, and reassurance. Asthma is a very important cause of chest pain in children, so especially exercise-induced bronchospasm or asthma. These children, they may not have any cough. They may have a chest tightness, and they perceive this tightness as a chest pain. And the key here is to ask about previous history of using inhalers, family history of asthma, family history of atopy, also to give two puffs of albuterol before exercise, and if this relieves the chest pain and the child feel better, this is diagnostic and therapeutic if the history suggests asthma. This is very common and is very easy to be missed. So especially during the visit, you may not, and most commonly you will not hear any wheezing and the lung will sound very normal. Pneumonia can cause chest pain and anxiety, especially in adolescents. Recent major stressful events like separation from friends, death of one family members, or divorce. Reflux can also cause chest pain. So ask about pain after meals. Or history, family history of reflux or gastroesophageal reflux disease, or previous history of using antacid or medication for ulcers. Sickle cell disease also can present with acute chest syndrome or pain crisis. This is a 13 years old female. While standing and waiting for her turn in school during lunch, she felt lightheaded, weak, nauseous, and passed out for 5 seconds. She looked pale and had cold sweat. Her friends called her and helped her to lay down and felt better after. She has no history of seizure or any other medical problem. Her physical examination is normal. What is the best course of action? The key word in this presentation is this 13 years old female passed out while she's standing. Not in action, not in motion, not moving, not running, not swimming. And also passing out during sitting also can happen, but passing out or loss of consciousness while laying down is abnormal. Passing out or loss of consciousness while or during running or swimming is abnormal, is a red flag. Also, she has a typical prodrome symptoms of a syncope or vasovagal syncope, lightheadedness, weakness, nausea, and the symptom disappeared when she lay down and she regained her consciousness with no problem. She has no history of seizure. There is no congenital heart disease or any other medical problem like diabetes or hypoglycemia. So the treatment here is reassurance. The treatment or the management of vasovagal syncope is reassurance. No EKG, no lab whatsoever, just reassurance when the presentation is typical. Syncope is very common in adolescents. Syncope is a temporary loss of consciousness, maybe due to generalized cerebral hypoperfusion or neurologic disorders. Clinical presentation of syncope, the prodrome or the symptom before the actual syncope is palpitations, tachycardia, lightheadedness, dizziness, weakness, pallor or nausea, cold sweat, blurred vision, hearing loss. All of these symptoms may precede the syncope and occurs with standing or sitting, not laying down, not during running or exercise, not during swimming. This is not the vasovagal syncope if it occurs during action. Temporary loss of consciousness, and the symptom will be relieved when the child is laying down. Vasovagal syncope is the most common cause of syncope. It is impaired response of the autonomic nervous system, and this will cause transient self-limited loss of consciousness with inability to maintain the postural tone that is followed by spontaneous recovery. This is the most common cause. This is the most common presentation in children. Vasovagal syncope is the most common cause of syncope in children, but we have to be familiar and we have to know the rare causes of syncope and red flags. Cardiac structural disease can be associated with syncope, for example, hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, aortic stenosis, coronary artery anomalies, cardiac arrhythmias, for example, ventricular tachycardia, complete heart block, non-cardiac mechanism, for example, seizures, hypoglycemia, and psychologic disorders. Red flags for cardiac syncope, and these are the same indications to refer to pediatric cardiologist. Sudden onset of palpitation, shortness of breath or chest pain before syncope. Syncope during exercise, during exertion, during swimming or while supine. This can be associated, like for example, in cases of obstructive heart disease or like in case of cardiomyopathy or long QT syndrome. Episode brought on by sudden startle. exercise intolerance and fatigue, age younger than 10 years of age, especially younger than 6, is unusual to have syncope, previous heart disease, family history of cardiomyopathy or channelopathy, like in cases of long QT syndrome, abnormal physical examination, bradycardia. Normally, you should have tachycardia in cases of syncope, not bradycardia. Initial evaluation for cases with suspected cardiac syncope, electrocardiography. You check for the rhythm, you check for arrhythmias, long QT, you check for left or right ventricular hypertrophy, like in cases of obstructive cardiomyopathy. Further evaluation, a 24-hour Holter monitor or 30-day event monitoring if history suggests tachyarrhythmia. Echocardiogram if the physical examination or electrocardiogram suggests that the child is having abnormality or structural abnormality in the heart. Treatment of vasovagal syncope, increased fluid and salt intake. This is the most common recommendation. In severe cases or in cases of recurrent syncope, fludrocortisone, midodrine, beta blockers, and in severe cases, pacemaker, if they have documented bradycardia and unresponsive to medical therapy. This is a 4-year-old healthy boy who presented to a clinic for health supervision visit. On physical examination, you heard 1/6 systolic, low-pitched vibratory murmur, best heard on the left sternal border, decreased in intensity when moving from supine to upright position. What is the most likely diagnosis? I will give you a few seconds to listen to this murmur. What is the most likely diagnosis? Is aortic stenosis, innocent murmur, pulmonary stenosis, mitral valve prolapse, or tricuspid regurgitation? The key words in this case is low-grade murmur 1/6, systolic, all the benign murmurs are systolic, low-pitched vibratory or musical murmur, best heard on the left sternal border, decreased in intensity when moving from supine to upright or sitting position. The most likely diagnosis in this case is innocent murmur. I will give you a chance to listen to it again because it's extremely common in children. This is just a simple classification of types of murmur according to the valvular lesion. For example, in cases of mitral valve or tricuspid valve, if it's stenosis will give you diastolic murmur, if it's regurgitation will give you systolic murmur. The opposite in the cases of aortic valve or pulmonary valve, if it's stenosis will give you systolic murmur, if it's regurgitation will give you diastolic murmur. Recommended steps to listen to the heart. Step number one, to listen to the heart while the child is supine or laying down. You listen to the pericardium, to the axilla, to the neck, to the abdomen, and fontanelle if it's still open. Then the child will move from supine to sitting position and you listen to the same locations. Finally, you listen to the back. When you listen to the heart, you need to determine the loudness of the heart, 1 to 6. So you can say, for example, the murmur is 3/6. Timing, is it systolic or diastolic murmur? Location, murmur can be heard in different areas in the pericardium, but you need to determine the greatest intensity of the murmur, and this will help to define or understand the source of the murmur. Radiation of the murmur, murmur radiated to the axilla, to the neck, to the back. The pitch of the murmur, if it's low pitch or high pitch murmur. The characteristics of innocent murmurs in general, typically quiet grade murmur 1 to 2/6. Systolic, all benign murmurs are systolic. Located over the left sternal border, possibly radiate to the left or the right sternal border, low pitched vibratory or musical, decrease in intensity from supine to sitting position. Innocent murmurs, or well known as Still's murmur, is early systolic ejection murmur, short duration, low intensity, grade 1 to 2/6, vibrating or musical quality murmur, located at the left sternal border and not radiating. Next murmur, which is very common, very important, is peripheral pulmonary artery stenosis of the newborn. This murmur is related to the acute takeoff angle of the branch of pulmonary artery, so the sound comes from the branch, not from the valve. And the characteristics of this murmur is systolic ejection murmur of low intensity, heard best at the left upper sternal border, and radiates bilaterally to the axilla and to the back. This is important. Louder in the axilla or the back than the anterior chest. Split second heart sound of normal intensity. Murmur disappears usually in 3 to 6 months and require reassurance. Venous hum is another cause of murmur and is a benign murmur. This murmur is caused by blood cascading down the jugular vein. Typically is louder in diastole as the atrium empties. The characteristics of this murmur, continuous murmur, heard in the infraclavicular region, usually right-sided, best heard sitting or standing, disappears when the patients lay down. So disappearance when the examiner applies also gentle pressure over the jugular vein is diagnostic. Pathologic murmur, the first one is systolic ejection murmur, crescendo decrescendo murmur, and this is best heard with the diaphragm. The first one is aortic stenosis, and the best place to listen to the aortic stenosis is the right side or right upper sternal border. Pulmonary stenosis in the other side, on the left side, left upper sternal border. Atrial septal defect, you will hear ejection systolic murmur because of a relative increase of blood flow through the pulmonary valve, so you will hear it, or the greatest intensity will be on the left upper sternal border. Coarctation of aorta, you will hear ejection systolic murmur or systolic ejection murmur on the left clavicle or the back. I will give you a few seconds to listen to a case of a severe aortic stenosis with a systolic ejection murmur, loud murmur. The next pathologic murmur is pansystolic murmur. This murmur of the same intensity throughout the systole and best heard with the diaphragm. The first example is ventricular septal defect, and this will give you high-pitched murmur with harsh sound at the left lower sternal border radiating to the back. The next example is mitral valve regurgitation and will give you low-pitched murmur, blowing at the left lower sternal border radiating to the left axilla and louder when the patient on the left side, left lateral decubitus position. The next example is tricuspid regurgitation. It will give you low-pitched murmur, blowing at the left and right lower sternal border. I will give you a few seconds to listen to a murmur of mitral regurgitation. Diastolic murmurs is early decrescendo murmur, best heard with the diaphragm and loudest at the left mid sternal border. Aortic insufficiency will give you high pitched sound, best heard when the patient leaning forward in expiration. The pulmonary insufficiency will give you low pitched early decrescendo murmur. Mid-diastolic rumbling murmur, the classic example is a tricuspid stenosis, and this will be best heard at the right lower sternal border. Mitral stenosis will refer to the axilla, so the axilla will hear mid-diastolic rumbling murmur is mitral stenosis. The next pathologic murmur is continuous murmur, and this is best heard with the diaphragm, and you will hear this murmur throughout the systole and diastole. It is similar to a broad sound. The classic example is PDA or patent ductus arteriosus, and the best site to hear or this greatest intensity is left clavicular region. Coronary artery fistula, you can hear a continuous murmur anywhere in the precordium. This is a 5-month-old female infant who presents with respiratory distress. Diagnosed with bronchiolitis 2 days ago, her symptoms keep getting worse with no improvement after albuterol treatment, which is expected in many cases of bronchiolitis. She is breathing rapidly at rate of 70 breaths per minute without any cough. So she does not have any cough or stridor. She is alert but not vigorous and has typical trisomy 21 facial feature. Her oxygen saturation is 85 in room air. Her heart rate is 180 beats per minute. Her blood pressure is 90 over 60 millimeter of mercury. On physical examination, her chest is clear, which is unusual with cases of bronchiolitis. Usually they have wheezing and with breath sound equal in both sides. Her cardiac examination shows hyperdynamic precordium 3 over 6 holosystolic murmur at the left mid sternal border, which is a red flag for cardiac disease. Her liver is 4 centimeters below the costal margin. Her femoral pulses are equal and bounding. Her capillary fill is 2 seconds. What is the best next step in the management of this patient to administer? So we need to know what is the diagnosis in order to know the management. This is a 5-month-old female. and she's having tachypnea, 70 breath per minute, which is very high for 5 months old. She has trisomy 21, and we need to remember that trisomy 21, 40 to 50%, they are associated with congenital heart disease, for example, atrioventricular canal defect, or VECD, for example. Oxygen saturation is 85. Her lung is clear. For 70 breath per minute in a case of bronchiolitis, you expect to hear crackles and wheezing, but the lung here is clear, which make the bronchiolitis unlikely in this case. And here you hear a murmur, a significant murmur, 3 over 6, a holosystolic murmur at the left mid-sternal border, and the liver is enlarged. So this is a case of congestive heart failure because of congenital heart disease associated with Down syndrome. So the best management here in this case, furosemide or diuretics to treat the congestive heart failure in this acute presentation. Very important to know that any child presents with tachypnea, clear lung, and murmur, you have to consider the cardiac cause in this case. The definition of congestive heart failure, that the cardiac output is insufficient to meet the metabolic demands of the body because of high demand, like increased blood volume or increased metabolic rate, decreased cardiac function. Clinical finding: venous congestion, pulmonary or systemic, poor perfusion. We'll give some example of the causes of congestive heart failure. Conditions associated with high cardiac output, like left to right shunt. Left to right shunt, usually these cases presents in 1 to 3 months of life when the pulmonary vascular resistance drop. So the shift from the left to the right will increase, and this will presents with congestive heart failure usually. And you can also see that these symptoms can get worse when you give oxygen, because the oxygen will lower the pulmonary vascular resistance and will increase the shift from the left to the right. This is also a key when a child presents with respiratory symptoms, and when you give them oxygen, they get worse. So you can think about cardiac cause. The example of that, VSD, atrioventricular canal defect, very commonly associated with Down syndrome, PDA, arteriovenous malformations. Other possible causes of congestive heart failure: cardiac condition associated with low cardiac output, for example, dilated cardiomyopathy, severe left heart obstruction, like in cases of neonatal aortic stenosis or coarctation of aorta, diastolic ventricular dysfunction, for example, restrictive cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, constrictive pericarditis, and pericardial effusion dysrhythmia, for example, SVT or supraventricular tachycardia. Clinical presentation of congestive heart failure: failure to thrive, feeding difficulties due to dyspnea, increased fatigability, respiratory distress in older children, exercise intolerance, gastrointestinal complaint like abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting, somnolence, anorexia, cough, wheezing, and dyspnea. Physical examination in cases of congestive heart failure, tachypnea, RALS, grunting and retractions because of pulmonary edema, pansystolic mitral regurgitation, murmur, gallop, rhythm, hepatomegaly, peripheral edema, and jugular venous distension. Investigations: pulse oximetry, chest radiography, echocardiography, brain natriuretic peptides is elevated in cases of congestive heart failure, markers of cardiac ischemia, for example, troponin. Management of congestive heart failure: briefly, treatment of the underlying causes, for example, correction of structural cardiac anomalies, fluid overload treated with diuretics, for example, furosemide, vasodilators, milrinone and nitroprusside, reverse remodeling, ACE inhibitors and beta blockers. This is the end of this presentation. Thank you for listening. This video is only for educational purpose and not intended to direct the care of any specific patient. Please consult your physician or the physician of your child for the correct diagnosis and the proper treatment. None of my videos can be superior or an alternative for the opinion of an experienced and licensed healthcare professional. Thank you again.